الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدًا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدًا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد بن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. My beloved brothers and sisters, once upon a time there was a man the likes of whom Allah did not create from the children of Adam. He walked on this earth sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is none other than our beloved messenger, Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He lived on this earth for 63 years. 23 years of those, he was a prophet sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What I want to share with you all today is the last days in which he spent on this earth, the things that happened to him and the things that he did. Putting this khutbah together has really been, for me personally, a very terrifying and scary journey. Because to see the person that means more to me than my mother and my father and myself, his last moments, the things that he did, it touches the heart. But I want to share it with you all, inshallah ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's illness started on the 29th of the month of Safar. The month of Safar, the 29th, on the 11th year of the Hijriyah, the Messenger's illness started, alayhi salatu wassalam. And it started after he returned from Baqi'. Baqi' was a place where the companions, a lot of them were buried. It was a graveyard. So the Prophet went and he visited the graveyard. He greeted his brothers and his sisters, his students and his companions who passed away before him. He went to them to send his peace and to give them greetings. When the messenger returned, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he came home, on the way he started to feel fever and a severe headache. So he came home and he found his beloved wife, Aisha, radiyallahu ta'ala anha. She was also sick. She also had a fever and a headache. So she said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Wa ra'sa, my head, it hurts me." The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to his beloved wife Aisha, "Bal wallahi ya Aisha wa ra'sa." Rather, Aisha, it is I who today feels that more pain than you do. My head hurts me more today, Aisha. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, based on the different narrations, he was either sick for 13 days or 14. The narrations vary. But from those 14 or 13 days in which he was sick at night, 11 of them he led the people in the congregation. He wasn't able to do it either in the last two or the last three, alayhi salatu wassalam. Let's inshallah ta'ala take the story of that last week of the Prophet's life, alayhi salatu wassalam. The illness became heavy. He was feeling, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the fever. His temperature was going up, alayhi salatu wassalam. And there was one thing on his mind. He wanted to spend that last days of his life with a particular individual, his beloved wife Aisha radiallahu anha. So he kept saying to the other wives, "Aina ana gadan? Aina ana gadan? Aina ana gadan?" Yuridu Aisha. He was saying to his wives, "Where am I going to be tomorrow? Where am I going to be tomorrow? Where am I going to be tomorrow?" And he was hinting if he could be allowed to stay with Aisha. But when his wives and the love that they have for the Prophet and their husband, each one wanted the Prophet to be with her, so they wouldn't let him go. So what he did was, he invited them all. And some of the narrations mention that Fatima intervened and she said to the wives of the Prophet, "Leave him, my father is sick. You're all dragging him from one house to the other. Let him stay in one place. Ask him which place he wants to stay and allow my father to stay there." Other narrations mention that he himself, alayhi salatu wasalam, he sat with his wives and he said to them, "Can I stay in the house of Aisha?" Because it's their right. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam took permission from them. He stayed with Aisha radiallahu anha. And when he stayed with Aisha, as soon as he entered the house, what she did was she did what he taught her for the years that she spent with him. She studied under him. She took knowledge from him. She knew what he used to do. And that is that he used to read the mu'awwidhat and ad'iyah and du'a. He used to read قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. He used to recite on himself the du'a. So what she did was, because she now sees that he's not able to do it, she took over. So she would read it on her own palms and then she would wipe it over his entire body. So this is what I want to say. If you're married and you have a wife, this is what you should be doing for your wife if she becomes sick. And if your wife sees that you are sick and you're not feeling good, this is something that she should do even without you asking for it. 5 days before the Prophet's death, alayhi salatu wasalam, what he did was, the temperature was very high. His fever was becoming very strong. So he requested, he said to his companions, "Subbu alayya, pour on me." Another narration says, "Ahriqu alayya, ama ahriqu alayya, pour over me, sab'a qirabin min sab'i abarin shatta." He said, "Get 4 skin where water used to be poured in." There was a container that they had that was made out of skin. He said, "Pour water in 7 of them from 7 different wells." He said, "Bring them and pour them over my head so my temperature goes down," sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the reason why he said, "I want to go out," is hatta akhruja ila nasi. My aim is to go to the people. Fa'ahadahum, so I can advise them of what is awaiting them. This is all I want to do. Get me those 7 and then inshallah pour it on me. The Prophet wanted to spend those last days advising his companions, telling them to rectify their situation. So the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he felt a bit good now. The temperature went slightly down after all the 7 qirab were poured onto him, alayhi salatu wasalam. He then asked for a cloth to be brought to him. The cloth was brought to him, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he tied it around his head and he made it sure it was strong. And then he went out into the masjid. When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam sat down after his khutbatul haja, he said his hamdala, "Innal hamdalillah, amma ba'du," to proceed. The Prophet, first thing he said was, لعن الله اليهود والنصارى اتخذوا قبور أنبيائهم مساجد. May Allah's curse be on the Christians and the Jews. They took the graves of their prophets, masajids, places of worship. This is 5 days before he passed away. This is the message. Remember, brothers, when you're on your last moments, what you mention are the most important things. You don't talk about unnecessary things. You want to make sure everything that you're saying is implemented. So he said, لعن الله اليهود والنصارى. May Allah's curse be upon the Christians and the Jews. What did they do? They turned away from Tawheed, monotheism, the thing Allah sent all prophets with. وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. Worship Allah alone, don't associate partners with Him. They turned away from them. And then the messenger said, اللهم لا تجعل قبري وثنا يعبد. Oh Allah, do not make my grave a place where people come and they worship. The narrator, he said, يُحَذِّرُ النَّاسَ, he's warning the people from worshipping him عليه الصلاة والسلام. Then the messenger went up and he led them for the Salatul Dhuhr. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went back on the pulpit after he finished Dhuhr, and the messenger went on to saying what he wanted to say. And he said the following statements. He said, أَيُّهَا النَّاس, O people, take care of the people of Ansar. Don't forget them. إِنَّ النَّاسَ يَكْثُرُونَ وَالْأَنصَارُ يَقِلُّونَ. The people are increasing in number. Ansar are getting less in number. Look after them. وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَّأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَا يَجِدُونَ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ حَاجَةً مِمَّا أُوتُوا. Ansar are the people who open their doors for the muhajirin. They're the ones who poured onto them their wealth and everything. They're one of the people who played the most significant role in the protection and the rise of this religion. They helped the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. Then the messenger said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَيَّرَ عَبْدًا. In this khutbah, the Prophet, he told them that there was a slave. Allah gave him a choice between this dunya and the hereafter, and this slave has chosen the hereafter. When the Prophet finished that, Abu Bakr was in the gathering and he was listening and he started to cry. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, he said, I was one of the people in the khutbah. I looked over my shoulder and I looked at Abu Bakr and I said, why are you crying for? All that Prophet mentioned was a man who was given the choice between this dunya and the hereafter. And this man chose the hereafter. What is there to cry about that? Lakin Abu Bakr knew that the Prophet was speaking about himself. He knew that the messenger was telling them, I'm not going to live. So that's why Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu cried. Then the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went back to his room. The next day, on a Thursday, 4 days before he died, the messenger came out to his companions. And he said, halumu, all of you come together. Bring me a paper so I can write on that paper for you something after it which you will never find misguidance. I'm going to write you my final words. Words of guidance. Umar looked at the other companions and he said to them, the messenger is sick. You can see his physical ability. He can't write. Let him be. The Quran is already here and the Quran is enough for us. Let the Prophet be. Other group of Sahabas, they said, no. If the Prophet wants to write something for us, let him write it for us. We want his words. His words are valuable to us. And Umar is saying that the Quran is enough. The voices, they raised in the presence of the Prophet. They started to quarrel. And the khilaf, this is what it does. When that happened, the Prophet said, قوموا عني. All of you leave. I don't want you all to be here. You're giving me a headache. That day we lost that opportunity, the narrator said, a letter that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could have written for us. But the Prophet said, I just want to give you three advices. These three advices are as follows. He said, أَخْرِجُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ مِنْ جَزِيرَةِ الْعَرَبِ. The pagans and the disbelievers, all of them, get rid of them. Do not get rid of them as in like, don't let them stay in the Arabian Peninsula. They can live individually, but they can't have a raya, a banner anymore. They can't have a government that represents them in the Middle East. Take them all out of the Middle East, he said. عَلَيْهِ أَمَا جَزِيرَةُ الْعَرَبِ. He said, also the delegation that's coming towards me, the Prophet is saying this, make sure that you look after that delegation. And the third, the narrator said, I forgot. Was he reminding us of the army of Usama ibn Zayd? Usama was only 16. Some of the narrations say 17. Was he saying the army of Usama, make sure that you look after him and you take care of him. So the narrator said, I don't remember what it was exactly. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that day was the last prayer he led. He led them Salatul Maghrib. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he read Suratul Mursalat. Ummul Fadl, she said that he never led us any prayer after that. Alayhi salatu wasalam. The Prophet's illness became more severe. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, my brothers, when he became sicker, that his temperature became severe, he said to his wife Aisha, get me wudu so I can do wudu. So he done wudu, he got up and he wanted to go and lead the people in the prayer. The Prophet fell on the ground alayhi salatu wasalam, and then he got up again. And then when he gained consciousness, he said, Asalla an-nas, did the people pray? She said, La ya Rasulallah, no, O Messenger of Allah, they are all waiting for you. He got up again to go and do the wudu and go and lead the people in prayer. Every time he tried that, he kept falling and he kept falling and he kept falling. When he realized he didn't have the ability, he said to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Murru Aba Bakr falyusalli bin nas. Command Abu Bakr, let him lead the people. It was as though the Prophet was saying, I can't lead them, and when I die and I pass away, Abu Bakr is the leader. He was appointing Abu Bakr as his successor. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu led the people. When Abu Bakr led the people, before Aisha told her father, she responded and she said, O Messenger of Allah, Abu Bakr is a soft man. He will cry through the entire recitation. He can't lead. He's a very soft man. When he reads the Quran and he recites the Quran, he won't be able to do that. He said, command Abu Bakr, let him lead the people. The day before he passed away, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he freed all of his slaves. He had 7 dinanir, he gave them out all as sadaqah. And Aisha radiallahu anha, he asked her if she can find some oil so that they can, or a candle, so that they can shine his room. They didn't have candles for days. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he died. وَدِرْعُهُ مَرْهُونٌ عِنْدَ رَجُلٍ يَهُودِيٍ. The Prophet died and there was debt on him. In other words, his armor that he used to wear in the battle, a Jew man was holding onto it, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he took food from him and the money was meant to be given to get back the armor. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We're now going to take the last day of the Prophet's life on this earth عليه الصلاة والسلام. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he didn't lead the prayer. And after Abu Bakr led the people in the prayer, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he felt a bit light. When he felt light, he wanted to come out. So he popped his head out alayhi salatu wasalam. When he popped his head out, the sahabas were all in the salah. They know the Prophet's house. His house is connected to the masjid. So when he popped his head out, it Anas ibn Malik, and he said, it affected our prayer. Our salah, we were all affected by that. When the Prophet popped his head out, he looked at the sahabas. In the narration, Anas ibn Malik, and he said, فَتَبَسَّمَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَضَحِكَ. The Prophet, he smiled and he laughed. The narration mentions the reason why he laughed and he smiled was for once he saw his companions combined together, united, standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mission accomplished. For those 23 years, that's what it was. That's what was needed from him. Now I say to you, brothers, what he wanted and he saw that day, and what made him happy, why have we left it? Why are we not all facing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not united on that? Why are we disunited? It was what made the Prophet happy, alayhi salatu wasalam. Is what he loved, what he saw, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Fatima, his only living child. The Prophet lost every single child that he had. And losing a child is a hardship, brothers. Every single child of his passed away while he was alive, except Fatima. Now she lost her father. So she said, "Wa karba abata." My father, she saw the house, how much he was sweating and the buckets of water that were coming out of him. She goes, "My father is in a state of distress." He looked at her, he said to her, "Laysa ala abiki karbun ba'd al-yawm." After today, your father is not going to be in this pain. All of this is going to end. It's going to have an ending time. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away when he died. When he passed away, Fatima, she said, "Ya abata ajaba rabban da'a." My father, he accepted the call of his Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. "Ya abata," my father, "man jannatul firdausi ma'wa," a man whose jannah is his final abode. "Ya abata ila jibril an'a." As soon as he got buried, on the way back from the grave, Anas ibn Malik was walking. Fatima came to Anas. She said these words to him. She said, "Atabat anfusukum an tahthu ala rasulillahi turab." She said, "How did your nafs allow you all to pour sand over the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam?" The minute they announced the Prophet's death alayhi salatu wasalam, the strongest of people, like for example Umar radiallahu anhu, a man, if we look at the seerah, we see him as a strong man. He couldn't take the message. So what he did was, he called the people into the masjid and he said, "Anyone who says that the Prophet is dead, my sword, can you see it? I'll cut your head off." Everyone was terrified and scared. Umar was not in his right mind because of what he encountered, the death of the greatest man, brothers. Until Abu Bakr came. Abu Bakr was in the outskirts of Medina. He came back. When Abu Bakr came, he told Umar, "Calm down, leave the people." He wouldn't listen. He said, "Come away from the people." Umar wouldn't listen. So Abu Bakr stood up, he did his khutbah, and then he said to the people the following words. He said, "Man kana ya'budu Muhammadan," anyone who was worshipping Nabiullah Muhammad, "fa'inna Muhammadan qadimat," Nabiullah Muhammad passed away. "Waman kana ya'budu Allah," and anyone who was worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then "fa'inna Allah hayyun la yamut," Allah will never die. And he recited the ayah, "wama Muhammadun illa rasulun qad khalat min qablihi ar-rusul, afa'in mata aw qutila anqalabtum ala a'qabikum, وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا وَسَيَجْزِي اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. My brothers and sisters, the Prophet left two things with us. If we hold on to it, we will be successful. The first of them is the Qur'an. And the second is what? The Sunnah. If we hold on those two, onto those two, the world's good will come our way, inshaAllah ta'ala. Oh Allah, do not make us from those people that when you meet them at your fountain, the day of judgment, that we are pushed away from the fountain. And it said, "Innaka la tadri ma ahadathu ba'dak." These people, they changed. They're not like what you thought of them. I ask Allah, it doesn't make us from those people. I ask Allah that we drink from the Prophet's fountain. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana wa ansurna ala alqawmi alkafirin. Allahumma ighfir lana hazlana wa jiddana wa khata'ana wa amdana wa kullu dhalika indana ya rabbal alamin. اللهم لا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك فينا ولا يرحمنا. رب آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. أقم الصلاة.
حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
استووا تقاربوا واعتدلوا، حاذوا بين المناكب وسدوا الفرج، لا تختلفوا فتختلف قلوبكم.
الله أكبر. اللهم بعيد بينه وبين خطاياك ما تبعد منه. اللهم نقني من خطاياك ما ينقض قبل بيض من الدنس. اللهم اغسل خطاياك بالماء والثلج والبرد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى، والذي قدر فهدى، والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى، سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله، إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخشى، ونيسرك لليسرى إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخشى، إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى، ونيسرك لليسرى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى، سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى، الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا، قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى، بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى، إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هل أتاك حديث الغاشية؟ وجوه يومئذ خاشعة، عاملة ناصبة، تصلى نارا حامية، تسقى من عين آنية،
ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع وجوه يومئذ ناعمة لسعيها راضية في جنة عالية لا تسمع فيها لاغية فيها عين جارية فيها سرر مرفوعة وأكواب موضوعة ونمارق مسفوفة وزرابي مبثوثة أفلا ينظرون إلى الإبل كيف خلقت وإلى السماء كيف رفعت وإلى الجبال كيف نسبت وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت فذكر إنما أنت مذكر لست عليهم بمسيطر إلا من فذكر إنما أنت مذكر لست عليهم بمسيطر إلا من تولى وكفر سيعذبه الله العذاب الأكبر إن إلينا إيابهم ثم إن علينا حسابهم. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.